In episode 1, we talked about liberal ideology, and in episode 2, we talked about the history of liberalism and capitalism, before, in episode 3, talking about neoliberalism.
TLTW explanation, liberalism is an ideology which was founded upon liberty and equality, essentially just a soft form of libertarianism. Capitalism is an economic system where all property is privately owned and managed and all association is voluntary. Quote-unquote, neoliberalism is a specific branch of liberalism which specifically focuses on laissez-faire capitalism, which I find personally to be redundant, and I'll explain why in a little bit. Your best explanation was on liberalism. I think you did an okay job there, but you still overgeneralized quite a bit. Your video on capitalism was absolutely fucking abysmal, using the Marxist strawman argument that capitalism is private ownership for profit and conflating government action with free market economics. It's so bad I'm considering making my own separate response to that video. And your video on neoliberalism, quality-wise, is pretty much exactly the same as your video on capitalism.
I strongly recommend watching those videos first, as without them, you won't really understand what we're going to be talking about today. In this final part of the series, we're going to be talking about the big problems with liberalism.
Teil 1. Die Nazis.
Oh man, you haven't even introduced your argument yet, and already this doesn't look too good.
The first problem is that once liberalism is established, it has a tendency to slide to the right wing.
Wait, you mean that an ideology which fundamentally values free association and individual autonomy as some of its core principles tends to slide towards free market economics? Who could have seen that one coming? It's almost like free market capitalism is a liberal idea in and of itself.
And it does this for two reasons. Firstly, it places a lot of emphasis on freedom, particularly freedom of speech, and tolerating a diversity of opinions.
So, you're opposed to liberalism because you don't like people having the right to speak and thinking differently than you. So far, out of the points you've tried to make, we've gotten everything I don't like is literally Hitler, and people who disagree with me shouldn't have the right to speak. One of which is a character assassination, the other of which can't be justified using any strain of consistent logic. Why is it that people who agree with you are allowed to speak? What exactly is the reason others shouldn't have their opinions known even if they're wrong? What justification do you have to arbitrarily silence others for not agreeing with you? What would stop others from doing the same to you and using the same argument that you're using right now to silence others?
Though as we've seen by now, it does make some exceptions.
Like what? You're seriously going to just claim that people you don't agree with aren't consistent in their reasoning, and then not try to explain why?
And that's all cool, and freedom of speech is great.
Unfucking real. And these people wonder why everyone hates them and think they're the most unprincipled garbage on the face of the planet.
However, that does make liberalism very susceptible to propaganda.
Oh, you mean like your video? Well, in that case, you can just refute it and expose those bad ideas, like I'm doing right now.
Philosophers like John Rawls and Karl Popper did work on this. It's called the paradox of tolerance. What do we do if we want to be tolerant, but somebody is expressing viewpoints that are themselves intolerant, even to the extent that they're incompatible with liberalism?
Here is the problem with the paradox of tolerance. For instance, you could say on a stage, as horrible as it would be, that you believe all black people should be deported to Africa. Your ideas can be refuted or, you know, they could be promoted. Either way, that association is perfectly compatible with liberalism. What wouldn't be compatible with liberalism would be for the person who wants to deport all black people to get an army and do so. The reason these two things are different is due to the distinction between action and speech. Someone who expresses a point of view is not necessarily going to influence people to do things, and people listening are individuals who make their own interpretations of how to apply the presented ideas to themselves in their own actions. In other words, the paradox of tolerance is absolutely stupid because it conflates ideas with actions and argues that there's no nuance or individuality in rationale, which is so false that it can be debunked with basic observation.
But actually, academic philosophers were beaten to the punch on this question by actual fascists. Nazi philosopher Carl Schmitt realized that in a liberal society like interwar Germany, the Nazis could disguise their propaganda as just another political viewpoint.
Well, I mean, that's what it was. I mean, yeah, they used a lot of propaganda, of course, but they were just simply another political ideology. What, you think people prior to 1933 knew that the Nazis were going to Holocaust the Jews? But really, it's only specific sects of liberalism that support democracy, such as the social liberals, but the Enlightenment classical liberals, which are the ones that you were clearly referring to here in this video, were famously incredibly skeptical of democracy for exactly the reason you just presented. But that's not a problem with speech and individualism, that's a problem with democracy, which individualism is incompatible with.
And so demand that their viewpoint be heard.
Now you're confusing the right to speech with the imagined right to association. Speech is a right which you are naturally entitled to, since the only way to restrict speech would be through arbitration, making it a negative right. However, in order for you to be quote-unquote entitled to have others listen to you, you would have to force association, which is not what liberals advocate for, and would have to oppress others in order for that entitlement to be reached, meaning that it is not a right, since it is blatantly inconsistent to demand to be entitled to associate with someone else, and therefore logically cannot exist for the same reason that you can't expect to speak freely while others can't speak.
Even though they weren't really debating using facts and reason at all, because they were spreading propaganda, they could take advantage of the liberal love of tolerance and free speech to spread their ideology under the radar, pretending to value liberalism even whilst preparing its destruction.
Please refer to my earlier points regarding speech, refutation, and democracy.
And that's exactly what happened. And something similar is happening with right-wing groups now. I've talked before on the show about how white supremacist propaganda works these days, and ContraPoints has an excellent video on how white supremacists, or the alt-right as they call themselves, spread propaganda under the guise of liberal free speech.
Your video on the subject makes the same stupid argument that you tried to make here, being that words and actions are the same thing, which I just refuted a moment ago. As for the ContraPoints video cited, that was a refutation of white nationalism, which, on top of not even being relevant to the argument, isn't even something which liberalism supports or ever claimed to be in support of, unless you're arguing that liberalism is the same as white nationalism because liberal ethics wouldn't have white nationalist ideas censored. In which case, you're an even bigger idiot than I previously thought.
And liberals will help them do it. Interview them, offer them platforms, complain when leftists shut them down, without really digging into the ideologies on either side there. There's a reason that certain YouTube channels who bill themselves as classical liberals, not naming any names or calling anyone out or anything, have found over the years that they get a lot of attention from the far right.
Ah, I see what you did there. You made a very clear inference to Sargon of Akkad and Dave Rubin to accuse them of things which are untrue. Both Dave Rubin and Sargon of Akkad have made many videos critiquing the alt-right, and Sargon of Akkad gets shit from the alt-right all the time. And Dave Rubin used to be on the Young Turks, for fuck's sake. Then, to avoid any criticism when this was eventually pointed out to you, you claimed that you weren't calling out anyone specifically, even though you clearly were, so that when someone like myself calls you out on it, you can attempt to claim that you never made any reference. Very, very dishonest argumentation.
That's because fascists know that they can count on liberals to give them the room to grow and recruit. But maybe it's harsh to say that that's a fatal problem with liberalism.
That is not a fatal problem with liberalism, you absolute fucking moron. That is a fatal problem with democracy and statism.
We could, in theory, counter that by educating people about how propaganda works and how to stop it. But liberalism enables the right wing in a second way, a more powerful way, too. by being so linked with capitalism.
So people can't be educated about propaganda if people are allowed to freely associate. That conclusion does not logically follow the premise.
I want to make it clear that this point is entirely separate from any critique of capitalism. You could be the most hardcore Ayn Rand-loving capitalist, and it would still be true that liberalism's alliance with capitalism causes it to slide to the right.
This isn't going to be a critique of capitalism. Now allow me to immediately, not even two sentences later, move on to a critique of capitalism.
As explained in episode 2, liberalism exists to justify capitalism.
No, I did not edit that in there. Literally, the next thing he says after, "This isn't a critique of capitalism," is, "Capitalism is literally Hitler!" Philosophy tube, more like, "Your philosophy is down the tubes, am I right?"
Left-wing ideologies, like socialism, are incompatible with capitalism. But capitalism is compatible with fascism.
No, it absolutely is not. Fascism is a system which collectivizes the society it exists in over the individual with the use of government force. Specifically, it seeks to create a centralized autocratic government headed by a dictator and forcibly suppresses association, speech, and most importantly, economic ability. This system is fundamentally incompatible with capitalism in that it suppresses property rights and association, while the capitalist system has no restrictions on association or property rights. And I'm assuming that your understanding of capitalism is the Marxist straw man version, where Marx represents it as having private ownership specifically to obtain as much profit as possible, which I find particularly hilarious because either you didn't read the sources you provided in the description, or you're lying because you cited Adam Smith's Wealth of Nations in the description as a source for this video. You know, the book which first described capitalism and correctly defined it.
And so, liberalism slides right a lot easier than it slides left. As an example, let's look at capitalism under some right-wing regimes. Ever hear of Zyklon B, the gas that was used in the gas chambers in the Holocaust?
The Nazis were not right-wing, they were socialists. Not only did Hitler openly express support for socialism on many well-documented occasions, he also nationalized the German economy through a labor union known as the German Labor Front, among various other points of note, all of which debunk the narrative that the Nazis were right-wing. Now, I have many, many in-depth videos explaining this now. I can link some of those in the description, and I will.
Well, Zyklon is a brand name, not a chemical name. The Nazis bought Zyklon B from corporate manufacturers, mainly a company called Degussa, which also processed the gold fillings of a lot of the people who were murdered.
The state coercing people and using tax money to buy a product produced by a market company is not capitalism, that's corporatism. Learn the difference.
Degussa is still running today as a subsidiary of the Evonik Corporation. Now, obviously, a lot of capitalist businesses that were run by Jews were shut down by the Nazis.
Way to BTFO yourself. The state shutting down competition and forcing association is not capitalism.
But a lot of Gentile capitalists and rich folks and liberals slid to the right and supported Hitler because he opposed the socialists who were challenging their profits.
First of all, they are not capitalists, they are business owners. Capitalism is an ideology, not a class. And by using the force of the state to shut down competition, they aren't even capitalist in ideology. They're corporatist in both ideology and function. Secondly, that's an outright lie. Hitler targeted Marxists because Hitler's view of socialism was one which required a strong centralized authority. Marxists opposed Hitler's socialism because Hitler's socialism was expressly anti-democratic. So he had all the Marxists killed as political dissenters not because they were socialists or communist, but because they were Marxist socialists.
Even though Hitler's party were called the National Socialists, the name was, deliberately, misleading. The Nazis actually hated socialists and killed quite a lot of them.
Just because you repeat the same lie does not make it correct. As for the classic, "they called themselves socialists to fool people" argument, once again, completely untrue.
As another example, in the USA in the 60s, Black Panthers like Kwame Ture noticed that a lot of American white liberals were willing to go to bat for racial segregation. Despite their apparent commitment to freedom, Ture's diagnosis was that white American liberals got economic stability from the status quo, and so they were more likely to side with white supremacist capitalists than they were with a black socialist like MLK.
Already did it once, so I'm not going to keep debunking the same straw man of capitalism. As for your source, you need to be more specific. What do you mean by go to bat? Give them a platform to speak their perspective? Play devil's advocate? And how did this guy come to his conclusion? This means pretty much nothing.
And another example, Ronald Reagan, to name just one US president, provided military and financial aid to Guatemalan governments that were routinely murdering civilians in their thousands because those governments presented themselves as anti-communist, against the far left.
And what does a government using military aid and tax funding to aid regimes with a specific ideology have to do with capitalism? You guessed it! Absolutely fucking nothing.
We're still seeing this today in the resistance a lot of liberals have to even mildly socialist politicians like Bernie Sanders and Jeremy Corbyn.
Or do you think their opposition to them is due to their support for economic policies which have collapsed every society they've ever been tried in? I think it's a little bit of both. Support for the establishment and the whole empiricism thing.
Versus the apparent willingness of the US Republican Party and British Conservative Party, who are still liberal with a capital L, to be soft on white supremacists and form coalitions with anti-LGBT, anti-women's rights creationists.
Donald Trump is not a white supremacist, and I'm not going to say anything about Theresa May because I don't know much about her, to be completely honest.
Part 2. Rational self-interest.
The second problem with liberalism is that it's wrong about how human beings make decisions. Liberalism, especially neoliberalism, likes to imagine that human beings are individual, rational decision makers.
That's a straw man. No one is arguing that people are completely rational. However, people don't do things to themselves which they individually deem to be self-destructive. In the case of the market is self-regulating because of that very reason. People don't wish to associate with a company which is not going to benefit them the most over their competition, which is why competition is such a heavy driving factor in a privatized market. A recent example of this would be the United Airlines employees caught on video dragging a doctor off the plane forcibly and giving him injuries. Immediately following this, they lost millions of dollars because stockholders withdrawing from the company and consumers choosing to fly on other airlines. But please do go on telling people why we're stupid and can't think for ourselves.
There's the focus on individualism, which we talked about in episode 1, and also this idea that the best outcome will happen if everybody pursues their own rational self-interest. That idea goes all the way back to Adam Smith, and is key to the way that liberals imagine people navigate the free markets that they support.
Again, there are two problems with this. The first is that the model of the rational, self-interested decision maker is too reductionist. Even if Adam Smith was right that the best result would happen if everyone did that, the point is kind of moot because people don't make decisions like that. You can read all sorts of psychology and economics books that'll show you this. In fact, I've listed a couple I recommend in the description.
All of the links in the description you're referring to don't even link to the information. They link to the Amazon page where I can buy the book, so they're hardly citations. As for the sources you've provided, you cite a book by Noam Chomsky, who's openly stated that he doesn't believe in any division of labor, opposes mass production on an arbitrary scale, and has once said on record in one of his personal journals, Living Marxism, and I quote, "There are supposed to be laws of economics, I can't understand them." You also cite Vladimir Lenin and Karl Marx, and I don't think I even have to say anything about that.
At the very least, it's not as simple as hardcore liberalism presumes it is. Second, yes, people can make decisions, but the focus on individual decision-making ignores any kind of systemic analysis.
You're right, but not for the reason you think. Looking at individual behavior from a systemic perspective is something which you can't do because of individual preference, utility, and all of the other varying factors which set individuals apart from one another. However, when taking things such as preference and utility into account, which are observable objectively, that contradict your collectivist notion of systemic analysis, that proves that collectivism is incorrect because reality contradicts it, what you're doing is rejecting reality because it contradicts collectivism, which is ignorant to reason, to put it lightly.
One of the best examples I've ever seen on this comes from Helen Sugar, who talks about the way we decide what to eat. Yes, individuals make decisions, but the options from which we can choose are often shaped by forces well beyond individual control. For instance, lobbying. In the USA, government subsidies for crops like corn mean that a lot of cheap, unhealthy oils and sugars enter the food supply.
Alright, you know what? I'm getting pretty fed up with this, so I've created a cheat sheet for how you can tell if something in the market is capitalist or not. If the answer to this question is anything other than a solid no, then capitalism is not the cause.
And attempts to change that have to confront the fact that Big Corn, as funny a phrase as that is a powerful lobby with a lot of influence over government policy. So if we're talking about things like obesity, which Sugar is, the individualistic focus of liberalism is gonna stop us from understanding it.
What? What does government action have to do with individualism? Statism is probably the most anti-individualistic practice right next to communism, which, by the way, can't exist without a state.
Food isn't the only topic where this happens. Maybe you can think of some others.
Really? That's what you're gonna end your video on? I'm done lying to my viewers for today. Go look for the information yourselves, you dirty peasants! Well, in conclusion, collectivism sucks, this guy's arguments suck even harder, and the fact that people like him still exist gives me great discomfort. Anyway, happy Halloween, everyone, I will see you all next-